So, Robert, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for this kind introduction. Yes, the times have been exciting, and I have published my memoirs this year, both written in English, translated into Estonian, and into Chinese as well, which is also quite interesting. And the title of my memoirs is Living in Interesting Times, Chance or Curse? But here I am speaking maybe more like an academic, though my views have been always affected also by practice. Especially, I worked in many countries, including Muslim countries, as a UN representative, for example, and my views have changed since I was quite naive advisor to President Gorbachev, together with the president, who was also naive from my point of view in many matters. Now, coming to the issue of state, statehood, and nation, I will start from the beginning of the 1990s and this decade, which also saw, among many other things, number of books and hundreds, at least, articles in different languages concerning the demise of the state. I would mention only two books which have influenced my views. Both I agree and disagree with the authors. This is a Japanese Kenichi Omei and Jean-Marie Guénot, who both published books in English with the same title, exactly, The End of the Nation State. Though I must say that the book by Jean-Marie Guénot, who was also the Undersecretary General of the UN and worked in many other posts and universities also, and I had an opportunity to know him personally also. The title of his book, which was written in French, he's a French diplomat, La fin de la démocratie, The End of Democracy, it was translated, the title was translated into English, The End of the Nation State. And I believe that it would have been better to have both these in the title, because the idea is, and here I come to agree with him on this and in many other matters also, that the end of the state, let's say simply state, not necessarily a nation state, historically, yes, they were nation state, the end of the state will also mark the end of democracy, in my opinion. These views expressed in these books and in many articles were linked to the processes of globalization, a new wave of globalization after the demise of the Soviet Union, the role of increasing role of multinational companies, the spread of liberal ideology or neoliberal ideology. So this all lead many academics to think that this really marks the end of the nation state. And there was a parallel in history, of course. Marxists also spoke about the end or the demise of the state, so under communism. And if it was more than 100 years ago, then it was the proletariat which would unite the world, and the slogan was, Marxist slogan was, the working class of all the nations unite. if there are people who know Russian, as a student, we made a mockery of it then, and the mockery in Russian was that Kolodrantsev всех краев единую кучу хоп. This was that poor people from all the countries come together, so we are all poor. So if this was the solidarity imagined, solidarity of the working class, then this 100 years later, this was the common interest of global capitalism, which would get rid of the nation state. Historically, it is important to also to look at the history on this matter. The rise of nationalism, the formation of nation states, and the emergence of democracy, modern democracy and modern centralized state, they went in parallel, not only in parallel, but they were influenced by each other. Nation states in Europe, or let's put it centralized states in Europe, emerged and fulfilled two roles. In the one, on the one hand, they were this was against feudal fragmentation in medieval Europe, which inhibited the spread of industries, trade, and so on. And on the other hand, nation states were formed against empires which existed in Europe. The first, it was the early Roman Empire of the German nation, the Ottoman Empire, and later the Austro-Hungarian and Russian empires. And I would like to emphasize that the idea of nationalism, that nations deserve or should have their own state, was such a liberating idea at that time. One of the most interesting British authors on international relations, and also not only an academic, but more even practitioner, was Adam Watson. Adam Watson wrote, I quote, "The self-assertion of the middle class in Europe took two forms, the demand for participation in the government and nationalism. The ideas of nationalism and democracy were interrelated." Of course, today there is a different attitude to these two phenomena, democracy and nationalism. Why democracy is considered by many, not everywhere, of course, as something like court motherhood and apple pie. Nationalism is a swear word in many parts of the world, especially in Europe. There were, of course, two controversial aspects in the idea of nationalism. I would say one positive, liberating side, liberating from the imperial dependency and participation of a people, or limited number of people, of course, in the government. And the negative side, the inclusion of those who differed, who were different, either by assimilating them, for example, Massimo, not La Torre at that time, but Massimo Taparelli des Aseglio, wrote in 1981, "We have created Italy, now we have to create Italians." But often it was done by expelling those who were different. American historian Charles Tilly wrote that I quote, almost all European governments eventually took steps that homogenized their populations. The adoption of state religions, exclusion of minorities like Moors and the Jews, institution of national language, eventually the organization of mass public instruction. The tolerance of states of Southeastern Europe for linguistic, cultural, and religious diversity stood in sharp contrast to the intolerance of their Northwestern brethren, and surely stood in the way of effective state-making. The failure to homogenize increased the likelihood that a state existing at a given point of time would fragment into its cultural subdivisions at some time in the future. Here, my only significant correction to Charles Tilly's insightful comment would be that Southeastern nation states as such didn't yet exist at the time when Western European states consolidated their statehood and developed democratic institutes. At best, these nations were struggling to break away from either Austro-Hungarian, Russian, or the Ottoman empires and acquire their statehood and sovereignty. Both of these nationalisms, Eastern European and Western European, were exclusionary. While the first was mostly anti-imperial, aiming at the creation of nation states in the East, that's to say, excluding themselves from wider entities, the Western European nationalism tried to erase existing differences by excluding or assimilating those who differed. The Eastern European latecomers to the European family of nation states are even today keener about the homogeneity of their societies and independence of their newly found statehood than those in the western part of the continent. Having probably a bit forgotten the bloody history of their own state building, Western European political elites are today rather critical, sometimes quite arrogantly, I believe, and counterproductively, which is also important, of their Eastern European counterparts, when the latter use even much milder methods of consolidation in their state building. What are or what may be alternatives to the nation state? Once again, of course, I include into this concept of nation state all sovereign states, including Switzerland, for example, which is not a nation state, maybe in its original historical sense. What may be alternatives? There may be city states, which have existed in history in ancient Greece and Mesopotamia and other parts of the world. And quite recently, maybe it was about 2 years ago, two mayors of big European states, Sadiq Khan in London and Anne Hidalgo in Paris, they published an article in the Financial Times and in Le Parisien where they advocated the idea that in the future, in the nearest future, these would be big cities which would govern the world, not nation states whose time had been in the past. So I am not very enthusiastic about it because big cities face their own problems, which are not less important than problems facing states. There are, of course, there have been empires which have existed much longer than even nation states in the world. And I'll come back to this, whether empires can emerge. Of course, following a classical book by Hedley Bull, Anarchical Society, which is an obligatory reading every international relations student, at least in the UK. So there may be anarchy also within states, not only in international relations. And by anarchy, of course, we mean not those bomb-throwing anarchists only, but the absence of one central authority. In society. And by the way, Hedley Bull, I don't remember what he, in this book, but he at least wrote that probably the Europe, the European Union, is showing some signs of medievalism. So there was a multi-layered authority in the medieval Europe, the Pope, the emperor and different kings and dukes. Now also in Europe, this is the European Union, states and regions who play the role. And of course, there may be a world government as alternative to nation states. Now, let me quote from one interesting author, which I believe the title of his book, which I bought when I was last time before the lockdown in the United States. I bought the book by an Israeli author, Yoram Hazoni, The Virtue of Nationalism is the title of the book. It is a very interesting, though controversial, book. Of course, one may say that if something is interesting, it is always controversial. What is obvious is not interesting, in my opinion. And I also, I am not only provoking when I write and speak sometimes, but also because there are many ideas which I have, which coincide exactly with ideas of other people. But it is not interesting to talk about them, though therefore I am maybe hetero in this largest sense that I like different people, different religions, different societies, and I acquire something from them. Okay, but Yoram Hazoni writes, I quote, "When the struggle against communism ended, the Western mind became preoccupied with two great imperialist projects. The European Union, which has progressively relieved member states of many of the powers usually associated with political independence, and the project of establishing an American world order in which nations don't abide by international law will be coerced into doing so, principally by means of American military might. These are imperialist projects, even though their proponents don't like to call them like that." And he concludes, for all the bickering, proponents of the liberal construction are united in endorsing a single imperialist vision. They wish to see a world in which liberal principles are codified as universal law and imposed on the nations, if necessary, by force. This, they agree, is what will bring us universal peace and prosperity. Of course, once again, a bit like Marxists, a communist will bring a universal peace and prosperity. While I agree with with some maybe qualifications, with the qualification of the American project as imperial project. I have doubts whether you can about the European project as an imperial, but a bit later about it too. In his opinion, there are two liberal imperial projects, one for the old world, the other one for Europe. Now, just recently, a couple of months ago, the book was published once again by Jean-Marie Guénot, with an interesting title also, De la globalisation à l'émiettement du monde, from globalization to the fragmentation of the world, is the title of the book. And I quote from this book now. The first one I quoted was written a long time ago. Today we have to admit, even if reluctantly, that what was presented as a universal project, a multilateral liberal world order, was a Western project expressing a transient moment when the West seemed to dominate the world. This ephemeral project served the interest of the American power that didn't hesitate to break rules if that seemed to be in its interest. But today we see that this imperial project is failing, especially in Afghanistan, in the Middle East, the failure of the Arab Spring. And of course, there are those quite powerful states, usual suspects, I would call, China and Russia now, and Iran, Turkey, even the American NATO ally, who are against such an imperial project. Now, what about European imperial project? If outside Europe, these were real ivory tower theoreticians speculating about the coming end of the nation state, in the old continent, where centuries ago these ideas and practices had come into existence, it may have indeed seemed that having fulfilled its historic mission, including besides many positive achievements like democracy and individual liberties, also colonialism and the unleashing of the two world wars, the era of the nation state would also come to an end. It started here, was then exported or imported to different parts of the world, but now it was coming also to an end. I believe it would be unfair to accuse the European Union of being an imperial project, because there is no imperial center, no periphery, maybe Germany, maybe from the point of view of some intellectuals, maybe this imperial center, but I doubt it. But one may nevertheless agree that promising and importantly acting on this promise to create an ever closer union, a kind of federal Europe, European liberal elites have gradually become more and more detached from the aspirations of their peoples. It has also become increasingly obvious that European societies, in contradistinction to political elites, are not yet, at least, ready to throw the nation state into the dustbin of history. Of course, there are European leaders like like, let's say, President of France, Macron, who is a great Europhile, I believe, and he is speaking not about the sovereignty of France, being accused by Marine Le Pen and others in France for that, but sovereignty, about European sovereignty, he is speaking. But even, let's take Macron, and a test case would be that whether President Macron, this Europhile, would agree to give up the veto power in the Security Council and to replace it with a veto power of the European Union. No way, of course. Because I believe this is one of these test cases. Of course, on the one hand, Europe needs more unity in order to face and in equal terms, let's say, China, the United States, maybe even Russia. But on the other hand, of course, European peoples don't want more and more unity. This is one of the most serious, probably general problems of the European Union. Because what let me quote a French philosopher, Chantal del Sol, who recently wrote that the populists, and I believe we had also a workshop here on populism, I believe that populists are a reaction to liberal elites, the rise of populism. Quoting Chantal del Sol, now, the populists, contrary to what some may say, are really Democrats, but they are not liberals. At the same time, universalist elites, like those in Brussels, are really liberals, who are not any more Democrats, since they don't like when people vote to limit some liberties. Of course, we see what's going on now in Brussels concerning Poland, Hungary, and so on. I believe how Europe can increase its weight in world affairs, strategic, also not only economic, having better relations, much better relations with Russia, of course, because Europe and Russia have one thing, many other things, of course, also energy and so on, but one thing in common is that Russia probably doesn't want to become too close and too dependent on China, while Europe has the same idea, not to be too dependent on the United States and not to become too dependent also on China. Especially in France, maybe I'm quoting too much French, because besides, I don't speak any other languages, European, but only English and French. French intellectuals, for example, Caroline Calacteros, a political scientist, wrote recently, strategic approachment of the EU with Russia would add additional value to Europe in new geopolitical games. And Thierry Montbrial, the president and the founder of IFRI, the Institute of International Relations in Paris, warns, if Europe and Russia will not find during a reasonable period of time a ground for a strong mutual understanding, both will run the risk of finding themselves as objects of a great power competition, which is already unfolding between the United States and China for the future domination of the Eurasian continent. And Macron also has made a similar statement as president of France. However, many things are easily said, but it is much more difficult to act upon then. And I believe, really, this is one of the problems that in Europe, and there are reasons for that, true objective reasons, I would say. In Europe, there are, of course, many, many politicians, but there are no statesmen anymore, as there happened to be Winston Churchill, Charles de Gaulle, and even Jacques Chirac or Helmut Kohl. So these are, during these quiet periods, there is a class of managerials come to power through democratic elections in European nations. And finally, the final point is that the nation state is also the final rampart against negative aspects of globalization, or what the French call mondialisation malheureuse. This is the invisible hand of global markets, especially financial markets. These CAFAs, one of my friends asked, "What's this CAFAs?" These are Google, Amazon, Facebook, Microsoft, and so on. So they have more factual power in many societies than elected governments have. And this is one of the problems. Even if elections in many countries are completely fair and free, elected authorities have no power to carry out their promises to their electorates, but because they are dependent on global markets, especially financial markets. Time of nation states or sovereign states is not yet over is that that the world is simply too big, and even more importantly, too complex and diverse to have its reach tapestry to be flattened into a carpet where only one pattern, be it of a Judeo-Christian, Anglo-Saxon, Confucian, Muslim, or even secular, liberal, democratic pattern dominates. I am quoting my own memoirs here. And Jean-Marie Quesnot, permit me to quote one more time him in his latest book, he writes about the need for a new Copernican revolution. This time not in astronomy, but in world affairs. And he writes, radical reconfiguration of the world, similar to one that happened Yes, I have misplaced my pages, probably. I wanted to quote him, but I can do without it even. Radical configuration similar to one that happened 500 years ago of the picture of the world is today needed. It should help us leave behind the Western-centric picture of the world and embrace the humanity in all its diversity. It is necessary to see the world history not as an unstoppable movement towards worldwide liberal democracy. We have to find a more adequate and less simplistic way of describing the world than one where democracies oppose dictatorship. In his well-argued opinion, one of the biggest mistakes made by many in the West is to reduce the complexity of the world to these two modes of organization of power, autocracy and democracy. And here I completely agree with him. And I am cautioning against policies of radical globalization, notwithstanding the fact that due to the vagaries of the fate, I have become quite a cosmopolitan who feels at home in different places in the world. Therefore, I would personally indeed prefer to live in the borderless world, imagined, for example, by John Lennon, especially if there are there were no countries to die for. However, this is not the world we live in, or even in the world we see coming in the nearest future. I am leaving aside, but I have written about the coming revolution artificial intelligence and coming transhumans and posthumans. This may be the future of the world also. So, and in that world, really, maybe nation states would not have any role. Thank you very much.